Morning, everybody.
Good.
How are you? So we have our 9.5.
Is it part?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. 9.5. That's it.
We can go up higher today.
Oh, we can. So we can.
Fifty.
Oh my! Then we're going to exceed the.
The occupancy.
The occupancy is only 40, isn't it?
49.
Oh.
We can have 49 today.
And what's my psalm today?
84.
84. Here we go. Okay. To the chief musicians on an instrument of Gath, a psalm to the sons of Korah. How lovely is your tabernacle, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the sparrow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. Even your altars, O Lord of hosts, my God, my King and my God, blessed are those who dwell in your house. They will still be praising you, Selah. Blessed is the man whose strength is in you, whose heart is set on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a spring. The rain also covers it with pools. They go from strength to strength. Each one appears before God in Zion. The Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob, Selah. O God, behold your shield and look upon the face of your anointed. For a day in your courts is better than 1,000. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. My Lord, the Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold for those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the man who trusts in you. There you go. Okay, we're missing that tray here, just to let you know.
Tray?
For communion.
Right there.
Oh, down low. Okay, and with this new table here, it's like all this space here. I don't know what to do with it. Anyhow, good morning, everybody. And let's see, I have an interesting opening today. It's funny, as soon as I get an idea on Wednesday what I'm going to be doing on Sunday, the news drifts over to it. So I should be giving openings about peace, salvation, and the rapture. And then, you know, then it'll happen. So, you know, there we go. So anyhow, what today is going to be about is willful blindness. And with science, it's annoying, but with faith, it has eternal consequences, and some of them not good. So I'm on Facebook the other day, and I'm going back and forth with a friend of mine that I've known since my freshman year in high school, which is, you know, over half a century ago. So he had posted From the Hill that was reposted by the Huffington Post, and it's the title was "Anti-Malaria Drug Touted by Trump Has High Death Risk in COVID-19 Patients, New Study Shows." So here's how the discussion went. I open up with a simple statement. I said, interesting, this has been used successfully for 55 years, and now it's deadly. And David, my friend, comes back, and he goes, oh, so you're not a science fan. And I said, no. I said, are you disputing the 55-plus years of successful use and minimal risk, or am I missing some other nuance of this conversation? And then one of his friends, Jill, pops in, and she says, it's been used for malaria and lupus, but not COVID, which is totally different. Jim Dwyer, Jill, I go back to Jill, I said, the complaint is that it will kill you. The drug has a benign track record up until now, is what I'm saying. So she goes back, are you disputing the science? And I go, are you disputing the record of 55-plus years? So Jill goes, that has nothing to do at all with what this conversation is, and he's using it also with a different drug, and I also believe that it may be in conjunction with some other diseases, which further complicates matters, and I had no idea what she meant by that, but I respond to all of them. I said, you know, it's extremely fortunate that folks that are suffering from lupus today and in the past didn't have the HCQ critics around like it does today, because it was a malaria drug long before someone stumbled onto the use of it for lupus, and it would have never been used for lupus, right? Nobody responds. So then I said, okay, do any of you scientists know, and I, scientists, know why HCQ works so well with lupus? And I'll wait, and I know it won't be for long because we have all these science fans here. So David gets back and he goes, your arguments are with the scientists and doctors who have performed these studies related to COVID-19. I put a lot more faith in them than any of the backyard wannabes. And I said, there's no argument. I said, I'm just a simple question. Do you know how and why it works for lupus? So he comes back. He goes, I'm not biting, Jim. Not my area of expertise. My post relates to COVID-19 and its use of HCQ. I said, well, why are you sidestepping the question? I said, what's the fear? And he goes, you asked and I answered, and that is my final answer. And it's like, okay. But the foundation of all science is to ask, right? And here I am being accused of not being a friend of science. So he gets back in a little triad here, and he goes, okay, Jim, this is where we are different. I respect the discipline experts of such people as lawyers, doctors, CPAs, et cetera, et cetera. I rely with a bit of skepticism on their interpretations of law, their diagnosis, and their financial advice. If I'm not comfortable with their opinions, I will seek another. Until these studies of the harmful and deadly effects of this drug with the COVID virus are disproven, then I will go with the most current and accurate data. I will not subscribe to any anecdotal evidence when my life depends on it. But that's just me. And I was like, okay, well, I wasn't referring to any of that, none of which, by the way, is science. I was just simply asking, do you know how it works? Which is science. So the conversation kind of went sideways from there. But here's what he didn't want to hear. And this is from, of course, John Hopkins Lupus Center. I would think that they know a little bit about what they're talking about. And I'll give you a few things that they have said. So hydroxychloroquine, which is also known as plaquenil. I'm not sure why they don't just stick with that. It'd be so much easier to say. One particular. Okay, all right. So we can't do different manufacturing names. No product names. Okay. So, and there's two others that are medications that were originally used to prevent or treat malaria. However, during World War II, it was also found that these medications were effective in treating the symptoms of lupus. Specifically, anti-malarial medications have shown to improve the muscle and joint pain, skin rashes, and you're all going to correct me with this, who are doctors here in the room, is pericarditis.
Pericarditis,
which is inflammation of the lining of the heart. Pleuritis. Did I say that right? Yeah, okay, yep, there we go. It's great when we have doctors here because I know I can have help. But that's the inflammation of the lining of the lungs, which, by the way, COVID is, okay, so, and other lupus symptoms such as fatigue and fever. They go on to say, studies have shown lupus patients on anti-malarials have actually lived longer than those who are not, and these medications are usually prescribed when someone is first diagnosed with the disease, which sounds familiar. So they go on to say, and this is a short piece, they read a long thing, but this is just the gist of it right here, and it's a quote. So how do anti-malarial drugs control lupus symptoms? Anti-malarial medications help to control lupus in several ways by modulating the immune system without predisposing you to infection. So a virus comes in, your immune system is here, so if it goes where your immune system isn't covering, it's going to attack you. Whereas it's modulating, you've just... No?
No, the problem with the immune system and the COVID virus is that in some people, it overreacts, creating a scarring of the lungs.
Okay, okay. Okay, so since they can't hear this, I'm gonna quickly interpret what you just said. You just said that what it does sometimes is the antimalarial drugs will overreact inside of people.
No? The immune system overreacts.
Okay.
Antimalarial drugs actually modulate the immune system's reaction.
Okay. That's why it works.
So that it doesn't create the extra scarring.
Okay. Useless, right, because then if you can't if it's scarred, you're not taking in the oxygen that you breathe in. So, okay, good. This is okay. So I'm going to shift gears slightly because, okay, you've got, you know, all these which suggest that why a positive result from using possibly HCQ for COVID-19 is worthy of at least discussion. And like, you know, anecdotal or not, there's been some successes. There have, of course, been some supposed failures too. This VA thing, I'm not even sure if it was a VA test or not, but anyhow, that discussion, let's move that aside. So, okay, so now shifting gears to something far more important than COVID-19, say salvation, which is where you'd like to spend the rest of eternity. If folks aren't willing to even discuss topics logically or even have a willingness to at least hear things out, where do you go from there? So my approach with my friend David with this conversation was to discuss the foundational aspects of the drug separately from the contentious topic of COVID-19 and its history, its track record, and as old as we were, the track record being as old as each of us were, and it seemed to be benign pretty much that whole time. So step back from salvation, even Jesus, and ask that person that you're talking to, eventually about Jesus and salvation, a simple question: have you ever sinned? I know I have. So anyone who says they haven't, they just lied. So proceed from there and then ask them if they are capable of reversing time and undoing that sin, as they will not be able to do that. So then the question then is how is that sin to be eliminated? It cannot. So point to God being perfect and desiring us, but sin separates us. So how does that work itself out? We can never undo what we have messed up, right? And so the answer is no. So how do we reconcile this? And there are countless arguments that the Davids, if you will, of this world will put forth. It's like, you know, I'm not going to bite, or it's not my expertise, or I don't care, or there is no God, and et cetera, that you'll hear. And you can put forth the effort to change their minds about those gross misunderstandings, which is fine and will take time and would be important if it were someone that you know or love, but don't quit. Keep at that. But at the same time, don't linger, because sometimes planting a seed takes a while to germinate. So just make your point and move on. But under good conditions, tell them how this is to be reconciled. And God, in his desire to have us, sent his son, who was sinless, lived the perfect life, and was killed for no other reason than he taught that he was the way out of this mess. And the status quo back then, much like the status quo today, they didn't want to hear it. But after being buried, he rose, was seen by countless people, and then taught that he had paid for all sin, but not one had, but all one had to do is to accept his offer by believing what he had done. So he was the substitution for each of our sins, then, before then, up to now, and into the future. And what you did and could never undo, he paid the price for it. Why? Because of love. And who would do that for you? Nobody. And not that even you could. So believe that Jesus is Lord and Savior. It's better than a vaccination, better than HCQ, and it was easy. And you did not have to do anything but accept it. So since you did nothing, what do you have to lose? Anyhow, dear Jesus, thank you, Lord, for this day, and may this service be good and filled with knowledge from your word about you and what is your message to us. And Lord, we will hear a lot of thoughts and prayers about folks that are hurting in a variety of different ways here and abroad, and we just pray that make their way through with the firm knowledge that you are Lord and Savior. And Lord, with those that don't know you, that we're aware of, that are going through trials, may they come to know you through that trial. And Lord, just give us all strength and wisdom and protection to get through this mess we call life here. And may we have that opportunity to convince just one person about who you are and what you've done and what the simple offer is for salvation. And we pray all this in your son's holy name, Jesus. Amen. All right.